எல்லோருக்கும் வணக்கம், புத்தாண்டு வாழ்த்துக்கள். ஒரு டிவியேஷன் என்னன்னா, நான் தமிழ் இங்கிலீஷ்லாம் கலந்துருவேன், மணி பிரபலமாக தான் பேசுவேன், மன்னிக்கவும். அதாவது இந்த லெக்சர் வந்து ரொம்ப சடன் சர்ப்ரைஸ் இருந்துச்சு. ஃபர்ஸ்ட் ஆஃப் ஆல் கோபுவுக்கு தேங்க் பண்ணேன், நான் அவர் பேசுறதில்ல கேட்ட பிளேஸ் பண்ணுறேன். பிளேக் வந்து எனக்கு ரொம்ப நாளே நண்பர், ஒரு 7-8 வருஷமா மேல அவருக்கு தெரியும். அவரோட அவருடைய ஒரு வயசு இல்லை பண்ணனா, அவரோட டீச்சர் லிப் வாய்ஸ் அவரும் எனக்கு ரொம்ப ஃப்ரெண்டு. இவரெல்லாம் எனக்கு வந்து லிட்ரலி வழியாக ஃப்ரெண்ட் கிடையாது, யோகா வழியாக ஃப்ரெண்டு. அதுக்கு ஒரு சின்ன ஒரு எபிசோட் சொல்ல விரும்புகிறேன். இதை நான் கேட்டது நான் கூட இருந்ததில்லை.
Start interacting more on the western side as well. So I thank you very much. My plan now is to speak for perhaps about 45 minutes. Anna, Borita, please stop me if you can ask questions and deviate. My style is pretty informal, so I'd be happy to take questions at any time. The reason I chose the subject of Andhakakkavi Veeraraghava Mudaliar is there's really not a lot of scholarship in English written on the period after the Chola period and the great masterworks, which is kind of the Kamban Ariyaparam. Once we pass into the centuries 14th and beyond, before the rediscovery, we could say the publishing and printing of the Sangam Lakyam, there's a vast sort of gray space in English language scholarship in America about those poets. And I tend to like to work on the outlines of the classical tradition, so it's something I've been interested in for a while. I think that part of the reason that Andhakakkavi has not been as well known as perhaps, say, the Sangam texts is Damodar Pillai and Uday Sa's hard efforts at recovering Sangam literature and really working tirelessly for their whole lives to recover these texts was also fortunately paired with mass printing in a way that Andhakakkavi never had at the dawn of 18th and 17th century that he lived in. So it was only really late in Uday Sa's career, after he largely turned over the Uday writing to his students, that he was publishing Andhakakkavi's texts. And the two that have been published out of the Uday Sa library are Thirukkazhukundra Ula and Thirukkazhukundra Ula, both of which are very much worth reading, in my opinion. Another reason I think that these poems are not particularly well known is that they're difficult, highly Sanskritized, a lot of Madhukri, a lot of Shlesha, in the text, so it demands a fair amount of skill to be able to read them. But nonetheless, these are very interesting figures that I sort of see at the twilight or the sidelines of the great classical tradition, so I think they're definitely worth exploring. We can only think of poets like Kalabi Kapulavar, Garakaya, Kumarendi, the Panya kings of Tenkasi, Adhikara Ramapanya, and those great texts, and how little they've really been worked on in English, just to get a sense of how much there still is out there to work on deeply post-Chola period. So today the plan is to look at Ula of Andhakakkavi Veeraraghava Mudaliar. Thirukkazhukundra Ula. Thirukkazhukundra, as of course you know, is in between Mamallapuram and Chengalpattu, a beautiful and very ancient site that has collected from pretty much every king from Skandinavia all the way down through Dutch Upanishad from Masalapatam in the 17th century. And every Chola in between Krishna III put Kalabhati there when he came down from the Rashtrakuta suite down into here. So an extremely important historical site. Ula itself is, I think, arguably the most popular of the Prabandha literatures. There's just shy of 100 texts that are available in full or in large fragments. And in the past, particularly in Kamal studies, the Ulas have been particularly famous because of their genealogical sections for the Chola period Ulas. So the very Bhubhula, Bhopakuta, we have genealogies for Vikramachola, Kulatunga II, and Rajarata II. Important not only to clarify genealogical issues that we find in the Sanskrit genealogies, in the great Prashastis and Maitirtis that they had, but also because, other than Kali and Pani, these are the first real royal genealogies in Pamar, in the Mubhula. And so that has largely been the focus of Ula's study before. In fact, the great Kanaka Sabha Pillai, when writing of Mubhula in 1893, translated the first 91 verses of Vikramachola Ula, and then said, the rest of it I don't want to translate. It is far too libertine to be put into English and far too erotic a character. And so there's a lot left in these Ulas that's worth looking at. And the truth is that they are erotic and they are frankly sexual. But there's a lot of historical import of the way that people cared about texts and the way that people read texts that's worth studying. So I just want to run down the Ula format quite briefly. It consists of two parts. We begin with a male hero, always male. The only Ula that does not have a male hero is one of the Pamartai that was written in the modern period. So we start with this male hero and we praise his great deeds, his famous lineage, all of his majestic past that comes from really mythological times, Puranic lore. And then we move on to moving in time, you could say, moving out of the great genealogies of the past into a particular processional roots of a moment. And so the hero will be adorned in perfect clothing, great adornments, ornaments that defy the eye, and will then start to move into procession. Now this is the really fascinating part of the Andhakakkavi, is the second half takes a very quick dramatic shift to the women's perspective, and the poems are written from the first person narrative point of women's eyes as they watch the palaver passing in procession. And the women are overpowered by the male's beauty. And I think this is really one of the fascinating questions about Ula that continues in South Indian culture to a large extent, which is that political power tends to be beautiful. And that is not a universal truth. And these Ulas work very hard to make it clear. So the hero passes by the women, they're overcome with love for him. They fall apart in the well-established 10 stages of desire that we have from Kolkapi and Kama Sutra and so on. And the interesting part is that the hero always passes by. The women are never satisfied and they are left harrowed, sad, even terrified. So as readers, because of this first-person vantage point that we have with the women, we're invited to share their experience of what it means to actually stand before a hero and see what beauty and power really mean to the inner turns of mind. It's very interesting that the women in the Ula try really hard to show no one what's happening inside them. These are secret things that they don't understand themselves, yet it still comes out and expresses itself before the hero. The other large part of Ula poetry technique after 12th century with the great Andhakakkavi is that the women are divided into 7 stages of maturity. So we start with Vedai, very young child, perhaps 5 to 7, and move through 7 stages of Vedai, a woman of perhaps 40, 42 years of age. And the real skill in writing in Ula is the poet working very closely to discern what sort of erotic emotions are appropriate for the age of the woman in question. So the Vedai, for example, will never understand what's happening. It's too early for her. And the Vedai is in some ways already looking at the past and understands the sexuality more as memory rather than as current experience. When dealing with a pubescent woman, a Mangai, 14 years old, the whole experience is terrifying. It's so powerful. So the real art is in the fine details of narration. This processional theme has a very, very long history in South Asian poetry. We can start all the way with Mahabharata, like everything starts in Mahabharata. The Kama Dikpitaya of Arjuna, when Arjuna tours the borders of Vanadvesha and meets different women along the way, the most famous being Ulupi, the Naga princess, who is a very important character in Mahabharata, for she is the one who revives Arjuna from death at the end of the tale after he's killed by his own son by mistake. We can then move on to great Sanskrit Mahakavya. Ashwaghosha's Buddhachandra has a famous scene of processional women desiring the young prince when he leaves the palace for the first time to see the famous triumvirate of old age, sickness, and death. It's quite interesting, actually. Ashwaghosha then reverses the scene when the prince renounces the world in the famous scene where the women are seen sleeping and they look disgusting to him rather than beautiful. They're drooling and snoring. We can then move to Kalidasa. Kalidasa uses 2 sets of identical verses, which is very intriguing that these verses, it's about 15 verses, exactly the same except for the names, to describe the same processional trope. So for example, in Raghuvamsa, the wedding procession of Aja, the women move forward to see Aja in procession. In Kumarasambhava, the women move forward to see Shiva in procession. The scene being interesting enough that Kalidasa essentially had to invent a city, Oshini Prastab, just to have this scene take place. You never really hear of Oshini Prastab again. We could move into Tamil as well, not too far after Kalidasa, in my opinion, with Uttolayam, which to me is a fantastic text that is worth reading. It's just absolutely gorgeous. And this treats the processional theme in single verse style. The first true Ula is Cheramana Parama line verse, Adi Ula, Tirukkazhukundra Ula. The Adi Ula, arguably 9th century, taken as a contemporary of Sundaramurti. What's fascinating about Theravada Paramal is he becomes extremely important for the Chola period. So Nambiyanda Nambi's early texts, he seems to care a great deal about Theravada Paramal. In his Thirukkazhukundra Ulavi, he gives more verses to Theravada Paramal except for anyone else except for Simbanda and Sundaramurti. And Theravada is with Sundaramurti at the very end of the text when they both ascend to heaven. These are also the famous scenes on the inner passageway of Thirukkazhukundra Ula, where we have these beautiful paintings of Theravada Paramal and Sundaramurti riding with their steeds into heaven, which BC actually was kind enough to arrange everything with the ASI gentleman in the street on so that I could obtain these photos. And now that they're out there in Thanjavur being presented next to the temple, they're just absolutely beautiful. Penyapuram, under the reign of Kulukumba II, really cares about Theravada Paramal. He has a Purana that's about the same length as Kankwars. And it's in Kariyapurana where the story of Ula really gains hold, and I think spoke to Uttakutra very deeply. Theravada Paramal goes up to heaven with Sundaramurti, although he's not invited. And he's stopped at the gates by Shiva and says, "Why are you here when I never invited you?" And Theravada answers, "I have this text that I'm going to give before you as my appeal to enter heaven. And that text is Thirukkazhukundra Ula." And we have this wonderful end of Kariyapurana, the very end in the White Elephant Saga, where Shastra hears the text being proclaimed, and even though Theravada Paramal and Sundaramurti remain in heaven, Shastra returns to earth and instills the text in a small temple in Trichy district so that it can spread throughout the world. So by only the first time, the Ula is a text that people care about a lot, and they care about Theravada as a Nayana a lot. Uttakutra comes forth and of course writes the very famous Mudaliar on these three Chola kings. His great innovation, and to some people his great mistake, is bringing the Ula out of the world of gods and into the world of human beings. So that you're actually talking about a Rajamandala of power when you're talking about beauty and kingship. Now, jumping forward to Andhakakkavi, 17th century, the really key point for me is that Andhakakkavi would have seen Uttakutra as much of a classic poet as we do. It's 400 years plus before he lived when Uttakutra was writing his texts. And so the question that I'm really interested in is what changed over those 400 years? What did Andhakakkavi think about these texts? How did he use them? Did he see them as classic? Did he care about them? What is clear is that Andhakakkavi's honor demands a lot of different things from its readers. It demands a much higher level of competency in knowing all the myths. It demands a lot better knowledge of intricate hamar such as Madhu than Uttakutra ever used. Again, these formal parameters of Ula by Andhakakkavi's time have been around for 500 years. And so he's working not in writing new creative genres, but working within a very traditional genre. And his challenge then is how do you make this thing that's 500 years old new and make your readers care about it? One of the big issues here for me is that Uttakutra was completely wedded to the fortunes of the Chola court. There's really nothing that Uttakutra says that we have that would ever deviate from praise for the kings that he served. Andhakakkavi didn't have that kind of situation. He worked for rajas in smaller domains. Even say bad things about him, and then go on to another and work for him as well. So I think it's a very different idea of poetry and poet than the great court poets that often define the classical tradition. Andhakakkavi can say, "I don't like you, I'm never going to deal with you again," and just leave. There's actually a famous poem, little Vasekavi that he wrote when he was down in Jaffna as a blind poet, being gifted an elephant and a lot of gold. And he wrote a short poem saying, "I'm in Sri Lanka and you give me an elephant. What do I do with that? I'm blind." And he leaves. You would never hear that from Uttakutra talking about his Chola lords. Now, just a brief biography of Uttakutra. As the name suggests, in his traditional words, he was born blind. And I think this is a beautiful thing that he writes Ulas, which are all about vision and all about beauty, and he never saw. He sees with the Kavikan, and this is the way that people always talk about his writing, is he has the Ahakam, the Kavikan. Most of what we know about him comes from these Manipal collections in Palmer, Mahler, We know that he was born close to Kanchipuram, and even as a child was such a prodigy that he was brought before Sarvapurana Kachapur in Kanchi to train under him. He also became an established musician and learned Ashtabalana by the time that he was a young man. He marries, and probably the most famous story about Andhakakkavi is that his marriage was deeply unhappy because he never made enough money. So one time he comes home to his wife, and his wife says, "Ah, empty-handed again, aren't you?" And he just leaves. And that begins his life of a wandering poet. And he wanders the length and breadth of Arnhem and Garwan over his life. He sings of himself in most of his verses. This is another really different thing to me from Wentworth. We, of course, have this in Myanmar poetry, in the Greek poetry of the Moor. But we don't really have this, except perhaps with Kamban, in the great Mahakavyas of the Chola period, of poets really singing of themselves. In a little Vasaikavi, for example, he sings about being robbed by Gariha in Lilipur. And he sings about how he's never going to go back to Lilipur because it's just a town full of police, and he hates the place. Again, you've never seen this in the earlier period. I have a little Vasaikavi here that he wrote that I really like. This is when he found that he was not paid well enough by his patron. And so I quote, "I composed a poem believing Sarayan Dinakaran to be a gentleman worthy of polished palm, but he acted just like a drunk, giving no thought at all to generosity and what poets can say." And the fact that we still have Vasaikavi, this is the only thing that we know about Sarayan right now, is that he didn't pay Andhakakkavi well enough. So, these are these poets that are just wonderful, of this individual value coming out of the poet. We see here a poet's new skill of using words about himself, becoming an individual in ways that I don't see happening with the court poets like Jayan Wonder or Wotakuta. If you look at the laws that had come before him, Wotakuta, Charman Paramala, even Namya Karunambi, who sings very personally in his Dirgoda Thirundari, he never mentions himself when he sings his Ulama like on Samanda, and the other Ulama poets never sing of themselves. These earlier poets glorified rule and kept themselves behind the curtain. And in Andhakakkavi's case, as I think we'll see, it happens very differently. So the big question here then is, what happens to the patrons? Like, why would you be a patron if you're never going to be mentioned in the text, and you know that Andhakakkavi can write something quite terrible about you, that he's not happy? Before, of course, these big moments of praise were paying court poets or gilding the Chidambaram shrine, making these things last as public testaments to devotion. And I see in Andhakakkavi's life a very changing circumstance where the real circumstance of devotion actually involved the autoritrum of the text and having the patron of the text there with the poet as the text is first premiered. So the patron's relationship has changed a little bit. He's sort of set back from what used to be inside the verses. But we have a new mode of textuality that's focused much more on the performance. And so the autoritrum of the text is going to demand the patron being there. We have actually, in our novel of Thirukkazhukundra Ula, the letter that Andhakakkavi sent to Sitakavi for Timriya Apoyan, who was the patron of his Thirukkazhukundra Purana. And the letter is in beautiful verse, and it reads as follows. "This letter is sent by Veeraraghava, who is distinguished by his mastery of both types of poetry, the great old type of the ancient times, and the great new type of the current day. It is for Timriya Apoyan, who is a flood of meals and other gifts, an avatar of the endless shesha and prasangas, the light of the universe, to delight the soul as he reads it with pleasure. This letter is for you to keep, and once you have read it, be sure not to miss coming to the first Arangetram of my Thirukkazhukundra Purana, which I have been working on for these long years. After hearing it in the company of fine poets, please provide me with money to go on to the Chola country. Please do not disregard this letter I have composed, and be sure to come on this Friday." So this wonderful little note out of the centuries coming here, inviting the patron to the performance. And I think here, the phrase, "this letter is for you to keep," is not an empty gesture. This is a Sitakavi written in beautiful verse that the patron would keep the preservation in verse that he was the patron and poems that I made from the Nisipu Kavi that they were receiving, I think that the patrons are still there in a very strong way in these texts. Now I want to turn now to what Andhakakkavi means in this letter I just referred to when he says that he's a master of both types of poetry. He's a master of the ancient type, and he's a master of the new type. What we see again and again in his texts is that Andhakakkavi always refers to poets that came before him that he cares about. So if we look at his Avayanika to Thirukkazhukundra Ula, which is an amazing text, he writes, "The Lord of Ahur's heart melted because of the Adi Ula, and I am just a simple man who ventured to melt his heart by singing an Ula of my own. I am like a lonely earthworm gnawing away on great Meru mountain, which was already softened by the mighty serpent in the Lord's unradiant hand." Right, so we have the image of Meru here being twisted with Vasuki around it for the turning of the ocean. And we have the image of Meru serving as the vidu for the famous Tripuratika vision of the burning of the triple city. It's beautiful too because he calls himself an earthworm churning through the mountain, probably a reference to the fact that he's blind. But there's a little shadow here. He's not just repeating things. You're taking old things like Meru and putting them to new purposes, right? Just like the vidu, or like the churning of the ocean. His audience, we also know, found a lot to admire in the fact that he revered the classics. So we have a nice pani bottle from Maulana Tanile that states when the Raja of Kayathadu first heard this text, he composed a verse of praise and response. And that verse is, "The poetry of Uttaputtan and the eminent poetry of Kamban dwindled like the lamp in the broad daylight. Once they have heard the poetry that this Devala recites, his poetry spreads throughout the ages." I want to go on with this with a more involved set of references that Andhakakkavi uses in his own poetry. This to me is a really amazing moment in all literary history. Now, this set of verses comes from Andhakakkavi's Seyur Murugamilaikamar. I don't think anybody has yet worked on this text in English since it's been published. Open season in some ways. It's a really beautiful text. Just read a little bit here and follow the sort of journey of texts that he takes as we move towards Skanda's mountain. "Come and play, Moon. You can chant the six syllables as you take the path to Murim, which ends all karma without fail. You can flourish as you praise the meters of Arunagiri Nadan's beautiful heart in the presence of the Lord. You can gaze on the holy Lord of Karakundra, the thriving city of our beloved, the king of the world. You can see the ocean that is Skandapuram, where the story of the battle of hostile Shuburan emerged. You can study the Kaliban Ba verses in the holy Ula that Kaviraja Jaya Pillai wrote about this god and let it melt your heart. You can give your critical ear to the Kalamagam poem and the Pillaikamar poem recited by the poet Veeraraghava." He's talking about the poet that he's talking about while he's talking about it. It's a very beautiful moment. "Enter the bright golden temple here, and you can enjoy yourself. Come and play with Skanda, who rides on his mail, a veil in his able hand." So we begin following these conventions of Vilaikamar with an invitation for the moon to come and play with the child god Skanda at his home in Seyur. But then the question is, how is the moon going to get there? And the voyage merges movement along a path and movement through texts, as the moon's journey is laid out through these classics of the past. So the moon can chant the six syllables of God's mantra and take the path of Murugan, a lovely allusion here probably to Murugatri Pare. We then move to Nakhir's poem, Murugatri Pare, with his reference of the six syllables and taking the Pare to Murugan. The moon can then wax as he enjoys the Amritam of the various meters used in Pirupuhar, Arunagiri Nadar's 15th century poem to Skanda, so we're moving forward through time. We continue as the moon is told he can shine over that ocean that is Kandavaram, the text that was so central to Andhakakkavi's own scholarly lineage as he trained under Kandavaram Kachapur. And then we reach our prized destination where he starts talking about the texts of Seyur while he's at Seyur. So he calls attention to Tehran Kaviraja Pillai's 16th century Seyur Murugan Ula, and then speaks very briefly of his own Kalamukam that he'd written before. And then inserts this famous reference to his own Sehwar Mudaliar, and allows the text to speak for itself. What's interesting here too is when he talks about his own text, he uses the verb critical, this idea of like, give it a critical listen, see what you think. I think kind of marking the autonatural moment the text is going to be presented at. Moving on to Thirukkazhukundra Ula, this is really one of his most major works. Probably Thirukkazhukundra arguably is better, but this is a fantastic text. I think it displays Shaivism in contrast to the early Ula of Theravada, that's absolutely convinced that it's ascendant. There's no doubt here that it has faith in its community. What matters here is really Karpundram rather than Shaivism in the sense of asserting relationship of place. Shaivism is already established. It's more about asserting the history of Karpundram at the place. So the hymn itself becomes this grounding of past time where mythical actions enchant the landscape. So every single detail of the mountain becomes resonant with the deeds of the past. And we find, actually, that when we move out of the genealogy of ancient deeds of the mountain, of which there are a ton that I don't have time for, into the actual procession moment itself, which takes place in Adi, right after Shiva looks into the mirror and starts moving, Andhakakkavi sings, Siva Paramat turned his holy ear to the Vedas, sounded forth in song, and to the sweet thunder of our four hooves. This is also something that you don't see before in the earlier Vedas. You do see the Vedas being recited, but not a put, some bandar sudar murti in Manika Vasakar's texts, the way that they appear to be here. We can also note in that phrase that the Tamil is ours. Andhakakkavi inserts himself in the use of the first person all the time in this text in a way that you don't see with the earlier Vedas. So that in the presentational moment when we sing Namkamar, it's speaking out and calling out to the audience and taking the irony for a moment. He does so repeatedly in this text in ways that can become almost very personal. There's a famous line in which he sings of Shiva who delights the mind and also relieves my karma when I sing on the beds of bangled girls. This sort of private, intimate moment that then jumps back into the text itself. When we turn to the second part of the Ula, and the women come out of their mansions to behold Shiva on procession, Andhakakkavi collapses the past into the present in a very beautiful way when he compares the women's thighs to the banana grove where Shiva rested after dancing against Kali in Tiruvannamalai. And there's this beautiful moment of bringing these past myths into the actual bodies of the women who are watching the procession. So I quote here, and crowds of mortal women in the towers, in the latticed windows, on top of the golden mansions crowded on each side. They and their servants gathered together, submerging the courtyard and the dancing pavilion in a sea of women. Because of their golden thighs, which are that pristine banana grove, they take ancient times in a distant past and they make them new. So the entire past is moving up into this processional moment. But who can understand this text is a very important question. It's a difficult text, not just because of the grammar, because it demands so much of what you have to know to make sense of what he's trying to say. Mastery of language, I don't think, would be enough. To savor this text requires knowing all the myths already, because he's not going to teach them to you. He just invokes them quickly. The myths are conveyed so telegraphically and in such rapid succession that understanding the text presupposes the Shaiva community. It's really more a celebration of that community than trying to achieve it. So, I want to have here like just a brief little example and then turn to my handout. He starts by saying when the women come out and the light is shining, that quote, the relentless dust from the sweet earth made every jewel crown like the crown that stopped the Vaigai on the home. And then he just goes on. So, of course, we would have to know a lot about this past mythology in order to make sense of this. We're called to remember the myth associated with Manika Vasaka, when Shiva assumes the guise of a contract laborer and agrees to do work for an old woman, Nandi, to help dam up this flooding river. But of course, he's a very inattentive workman and sleeps when he should be busy, lying down by the river. And his hair, muddy from carrying all these loads of earth, catches the raging waters and holds them at bay. And recall even past into the ancient times than that, we can recall another deeper moment in time also important to the total country, certainly. When the god caught torrents of water in his knotted locks, saving the world from destruction after Bhagiratha had pulled down Ganga from the heavens and it cascades down to earth. So if you take a look at the handout one, if you have it, which is just this table here, I'm just going to read what the text actually says, and you can see how much it demands of what you already know. So the reference on the left-hand side will be what's actually in the text, and then I'm just given who this actually is. The verse itself reads as follows. The child who governs us and the gods who eat ambrosia, the son of the man who ate stones for food in harsh austerity, the son who raged against his fathers, that those who direct their minds to the master will understand that even cruelty can be good. The man who long ago allowed fire, water, venom, bone, a palmyra tree, a door, and a fever to understand hunger. The loving man who took as friendship the elephant, poisoned food, the slave my mother, and the deep sea of his enemies. The man who employed in friendly service the cavalry and money without rivers, the troop of ghouls, the crocodile, and the lord's 2 feet. The eminent man who had earth placed even on the Gandhi's decked crown, praising the feet of the king of the gods on a horse that is a fox. The man from Buri, who rides on a horse, as the man from Kiranaga Wood, red flashing on his chest, rides the white elephant. The Torah, who worship the light, to drive off in the form of a crow the crime of rashly killing a cow. The Pandya king of the lunar line, who gave to the lord of Virayamadid, an amorous princess from an ancient line. These were the participants who watched Shiva on the parade. So you can imagine my despair when I first read this and didn't have any idea what was happening. This is part of the joy of reading texts like these is I certainly needed my own teachers and they needed their teachers. And I think that this is a real moment of achieving community, the bonding community, by forcing you to ask questions about the text because he's not going to help you. Now, if you look at the second handout that I have provided, there's perhaps we could say, a difficult side to repeating stories that everybody already knows, which is if you take Thirukkazhukundra Ula as just a narrative, in the way that you would take any poem, say, as a narrative, a story, it's a fairly boring story. Not a lot happens. It's very repetitive in the sense that Shiva is on procession. He passes each of the 7 stages of women. They feel desire. They collapse. He passes on. So what do you do with the text to make it beautiful if the actual narrative dynamic is fairly straightforward? Part of it is these deep references and allusions that Andhakakkavi loves. But another part is something that I also think is post-Chola period in its real heights, which is delighting in the sounds of Kamal as sounds. Playing with music, playing with Madhaku, playing with Shvesha, in a way that you rarely see in the great Chola period masterworks. So if you look at this handout here that I have, if we look at the bottom, the actual verse is, in its meaning, is not particularly elegant or fine. It's a nice verse. But then you see the marking that's actually being involved in the creation of the verse. So I have, of course, at the top the Tamar, these are Andhakakkavi verses, so that the last part of the final verse will hook into the verse itself. We see the marku occurring in such a beautiful way, pretty extended. And in the first phrase, this Namatu, of course, is going to be in the watch of the night. Mara does not change. Niru here, light rather than shadow. Kanchi, the girl, a famous Shlesha play, right, between the tablet and the girl. Ma here, a rare usage for Lakshmi. Virupan, a man desiring. Angai, Borum. So, first part, adored by the younger sister of the one who loves Lakshmi, whose girdle sparkles in the night, and in the folding in of the Maraku, taking it Kanchi as Kanchi, and Ma as the Mama, the mango tree. Shiva, who sits under the mango tree in Kanchi, where the shade never disappears. So you really need the Tamar in some ways to see the beauty of the verse and the sort of rhythmic musical qualities that are being involved here. And this is part of the difficulty for people like me, who the real situation is not many Western scholars of Indology know an awful lot about Tamar. So how do you describe its beauties to someone who can't get deeply into the language? Another reason why these texts are not always as well known, I think, as they should be, is they demand a very high competency. another sort of feature I want to point out, in addition to this focus on performance, focus on deep allusion and reference, focus on sonorous effects and musical qualities to the verse, is Andhakakkavi loves to question. There's an awful lot of statements of verses that leave things undetermined. Who is this Shiva? What is happening to me? I have no idea what's going on here. In one of Thirukkazhukundra Ula's best passages, this is the Benivai woman. So she's, as the name suggests, old enough to know what's happening. And Kamavela comes to her and is sort of anticipating the fact that Shiva's going to come, so he's going to play a game with her. And he stands off in the corner, and Benivai calls him over, and they start to talk. And we have this nice moment of, she thinks she knows everything, so here's this little passage. She called over Kamavela, who was standing nearby, and she asked, "What should we play, young man? Tell me." Kama bowed at her feet and said, "Amanai." "Make the Amanai balls, then," she told Wadiwa's daughter, "and give them to me on my own playground." Now he's going to start asking what kind of pearls to use for these pundit. "Is a pearl granted by the wishing cow good enough for use for this game?" he asked. She replied, "Those balls are only things I scorn." "Then perhaps a pearl from the moon, the home of clear ambrosia." And she replied, "Oh, is that moon anything special to me?" "A pearl from the tusk of an elephant, like the cloud up above. Is that what you'd like?" he asked. And she replied, "Ah, that's fine for Indra, the king of gods." "Then tell me, perhaps a bright pearl from the boar who wears a cool thulasi, or the lotus of the unborn god." And she replies, "Anything that comes from this world is purely just a crime." "Tell me then, how about a pearl from the bow in my very own hand, which shoots those panchabam?" She replies, "Far from it, you are just a minor god." "Tell me then, would a pearl that had grown inside the bamboo be nice?" And she replies, "They say that that is the very form of the father with the three holy eyes." Another deep allusion to the Thirunavali myth, where the pearls are growing inside bamboo that Shiva sets up as the baby. So she's happy that she wants them. Mother then makes the Amanai balls with those pearls and gave them to her with a bow. And the woman in the garland in her hair took them and she began to play. So she's got it all figured out until the very moment that Shiva arrives. And then all of a sudden, instead of Shiva asking the questions, she asks all the questions and she receives no response. She fell at the feet of the Lord of Gangatulam, the master of the trident, the head in his hand. The Lord of waves of the river Ganges in his fanning matted locks. She saw the holy face that flows with compassion of the Lord who presides there where the vultures worship, and she was overjoyed. Her eyes misted with tears. "Look," she fled to him, "I have reason to beg. Lord of the Shiva world, beautiful god of the land, whose beauty is so great, you commanded a crore of rudras with ease in the war against the raging asuras. Won't you now go to war with that night-roaming moon?" Of course, because the moon is already starting to burn her in her mind. "Does the curse of the sage, furious with the strong-willed Rakshasa, who takes lives, not extend to the son of the god with these blood-red eyes? Is the trouble that your white bull makes for Garuda, who has had countless victories, not also for the nightingale and the sweet cuckoo? The minister who once finished off his silver color of leprosy by means of that clear tirtha of Thirukkazhukundram, can't you finish off my own pasalai with that same water when my karma is so cruel? Your great girtas are seen holding all the rivers in the world. Why can't they hold the river of my tears?" "My God," she cried, "she collapsed. She was carried off by her friend, and she was laid on her flower couch." This is nice too, because Ula, I'm sure as many of you know, has almost no declined verbs. The Vinayatul, when they come, are usually in Vinayatul form, and oftentimes Vinayatul. And so this is one of the first times that you get declined verbs, this sort of peak of action. And I'm going to come using four in a row all of a sudden as the action starts intensifying. So the Arifai then yields, and her questions are never answered by Vinayatul. She's carried off, and Shiva moves on. She cries, and they hear the questions that the other women in the poem will also ask when they feel God's presence upon them. They raise their doubts above isolated concerns, and through the repetition of these questions through all the different sorts of women, they become questions that we too have, particularly when Andhakakkavi starts referring to them as namba questions, which is very beautiful here. Now, just a little brief touch. touch on this past one too, is why would the woman think that Shiva is even going to listen to her? I don't have a ton of time to go into this, but this is where Andhakakkavi starts using sonorific qualities of Tamil again, and plays with Madhaku to achieve parallelism. So for example, when she asks, okay, you've gone to war with these raging asuras by commanding the crore of rudras, now won't you go to war with the night raging moon? If you read it in English, it doesn't really have any connection. But the phrase that she asks this with is Nitata or Ehavo. Why don't you go on with your war against the night owner? And so she's using Nitata both as the moon, as the night owner Nilavu across the sky, and the asuras. And so when she's using the same phrase twice, it makes much more sense in parallelism. You've done this once before. Of course you can do this again. But Shiva, of course, moves in her question. Another point that I want to touch on Andhakakkavi's style of poetry that I see as new is that he fills his own poetry with the poetic speech of others, not just reference to earlier classical texts, but he actually cites earlier poetry line for line within his own texts. This is something that I think is quite interesting and relatively new in my own studies, so I'd be curious to learn more about this. When the women speak at length, they often reference verses from before. The famous story here from Thirukkazhukundra Ula is about a Vanika named Nachimuthu. Nachimuthu is supposed to have stood in a courtyard where the Bhaktavatsala temple is now, at the base of the mountain, and sing a beautiful poem composed by a Vaishnava poet every day in the morning. Now, one day a terrible storm blows in, so she's unable to make her way to the courtyard where she can actually sing this, and she is in despair because she can't worship Devi Vinisha as she wants to. So she starts to compose a verse of her own for the first time, rather than singing the poet's verse. And she sings, won't you come out and stand in my courtyard? The great part about this text is that we only have the first half of the verse. Shiva is said to come on his bull and sing in the second half, but no text records what it is. We only have her first gesture. As soon as Shiva finishes singing the second half, Ranika finishes the verse together with him and worships, and she grabs hold of Nandi's leg as he makes his way off and flies up to heaven with him. Interestingly to this too, I've seen this as a trope that happens several times in Tamil poetry. The composer of the poem that she used to sing sees what's happening and grabs her leg. So she's the composer of the kapi is pulled up by the performer through Shiva's grace, which is very interesting. Now, as I said, Nachimuthu's verse is never completed. And so what should we make of this? The fact that we don't have the second half of the verse that achieved the salvation moment. I think Andhakakkavi is going to push more and more to say, that's for you to say. You know, the performance is everything, and that was the moment of performance that she spoke from her own heart that brought her to heaven. And so we're not going to give it to you. You're going to have to do it too. And when he keeps having the women question like this, I think that this is something that he's pushing on us. Keep asking those questions. Keep trying to see what you can do in singing your own song. I'm here to help you sing your own song. Now, this ability to answer these questions is something of a function of age. So as the women get older, they start to understand that there's something about singing poetry and dealing with poetry that will bring them closer as they look at a moment that the kids can never understand. So when we have the Aribai, who's prepared directly to Nachimuthu, she calls out to the passing god, and we have something that occurs very rarely in Ula poetry, namely that Shiva actually gives her the male. Normally in Ula poetry, Shiva would never look at the woman, but because she sings out, he responds. And these are the verses here. And she sang verses like Nachimuthu, the woman who composed verses like honey, singing, you will never come back to this door, women. Woman, so at least give me that blooming coconut male that you wear. And he gave it to her, and they brought it and put it upon her. And that delicate woman wore the gold garland with the lovely golden color, and released the golden color of Asalai upon her, and flourished once more. So the older women are feeling the same depth of passion, but it seems like they know how to channel it better into the religious experience through poetry and through song. When we look back to the child, the Bailite, who's five, has no idea what's happening. I don't have time. time to do justice to this beautiful set of verses, but probably the most spectacular part of Thirukkazhukundra Ula is an extended Shlesha passage where the child is asking, what is this in front of me? And one of the pukshas of the Shlesha, which is the Uttara Paksha, is the women saying, oh, this is Karpukundi, which is one of the pet names of the god. And so you have these 20 verses saying, okay, you take sugar cane, you press it, you mix juice, you put it in the sacks, it tastes delightful. But the other paksha of the verse is all about Shiva as Karpukundi. And you can taste him like this, these savory moments of seeing him are like this, but she doesn't understand that. She just understands the sugar cane juice side. And that Shlesha ends up with these verses, which is, I think, very important to Andhakakkavi's spirit. Young woman, to sing on him or to love him, to keep adorning both of his feet, to reflect on him in the privacy of your mind, to walk around him, to seek him, to behold him, to touch him, to love him. How will it ever be possible, apart from that sweetness you already have? Very nice. The women are asking the child, but Andhakakkavi is also asking us as the audience. We, in some way, are the Vedai that he is walking us through the text with. We begin with the Vedai, and we move up to the Vedai of men with Andhakakkavi, working the thought supposedly into our own hearts, and the text succeeds in its aims. As I mentioned before, too, Andhakakkavi starts comparing himself to these women. He inserts these first-person usages into the verses. So we have, for example, the Lord of Karpundram, who has taken us all as his slaves. The Veda mountain, home of the Lord who has made me his own. The God who suddenly takes me and you as his devotees. This is new. This is not something that happened in the biblical mythology. When we see the Tenabai actually seeing Shiva in procession, this is this wonderful moment of the past coming up to the present, because she calls up the Bidhi, the female singer who's been around in all poetry since Sangam times. And the Bidhi asks the Tenabai woman, what should I sing for you? We have this wonderful moment where the woman starts to realize what she does want to hear. So the fine Bidhi singer praised the woman with lips like the bright coral tree many times, calling her long hair the pine forest. The goose-like woman worshipped, saying, girl with beast-formed locks, will my love be clear so the pure Lord who delights in love will go there? And the Vidhi said, know that the Lord with twisted locks will favor your subjection when he sees that holy desire that he loves. Know that all the world says we will obtain him out in the open, a reward not even received in Chitrangla. We will attain him right here on the hill. What's more, know the certain pledge made in the song of the last verse, Karpundram, the temple that makes passion. And that whole thing is a direct quote of Samandar's Padamantra Karpundram that he's inserting into his own verses in the right meter. Know that this sphere of 10 miles around the mountain adores him, my lady, increasing the passion that the whole world shares. She finished. You must arise. You must sing. The Shaiva poets of old, Samandar here, have promised it of this very place. He gathers the circle of all the Shiva worshippers through his call, spurring them to the devoted passion of the women whose Ula verses express so intensely. And I think the real point here is this is not allegory. He doesn't want you to see this as a metaphor, a symbol. Andhakakkavi is saying, no, follow the lead, get up, start moving, start walking around the temple, move towards the communion that these verses are spurring you towards, so that you can have the sweetness that lies within, as he says. It's a text in a very powerful way that is what it represents, in the sense that it's a text about procession, and it's actually a procession of verses, right? So it's the verses are moving out in a circular pattern through these stages of women over the audience and bringing them with you on that processional moment. Reading the text actually sets Shiva into motion. It would have occurred with the famous Uttava Murti festivals of the god being taken out in procession around the hill. And we can imagine the moment here, not through Andhakakkavi's own biography, but if you look at the biography of Uvesa's great teacher, what happened to his texts when they were finally finished. The text would be read and audited from, critical questions would be posed, challenges would be made. In at least one case, Vinatisundara Pillai wasn't reading it himself, but had a professional reader, but he was there answering the questions that were put to him. And after the successful judgment judgment of the critical audience, the text itself that we created around on the back of the elephant. We can imagine that happening for this text, a text about procession that creates procession that itself goes on procession, the sort of laminations of the moment of words into experience. I want to conclude here by concluding what Andhakakkavi concludes, which is bringing this all together with the Peyalum and the woman who understands what's happening. She's rich in years, older times, of course, we're saying 40, 42, perhaps. And in all the Ulas, she's representative of the experience of all the women who have come before, with the maturity to understand the emotions that are in her with her own knowledge. And so this passage is going to demand a lot more from its audience, too. So before I actually finish it off, I just want to read in the themes that I see as worth noting in Andhakakkavi's poetry that I see, if not new, as really being representative of the post-Tola period. First, the primacy of the temple site rather than the primacy of the person regardless of the temple site. If you look at the early Ula of Teruhan, it's in Shivaloka. It can be instantiated anywhere on the earth. Not so with Prabhupada. This is a text that's mapping out a topography of sacred space. And the other shrines are certainly there. They fulfill subsidiary roles to Prabhupada when you are there. The divine action of Shiva is dependent on the place in the sense that you can't expect the mountain to come to you. You have to go to the mountain. And that's where Shiva's effects on the mountain will occur. Religious confidence, in the sense that the Ula is difficult and insular enough that it takes a flourishing tradition of Amalshaivism for granted, presenting its hallmarks and the tales of its great saints as foundations for its own narratives rather than teaching moments. Textual insularity, that the cultural knowledge necessary to interpret a text like this demands an audience that would already be versed in its style and themes, and would demand good teachers to teach you those themes. So the Ula celebrates and enacts the community by celebrating the difficulty of what has gone before in its long and sacred past. Heavily embedded literary reference. I can't think of times in the Chola period that I know of, certainly I have a lot more to read, where you have extended citations of word-for-word texts of earlier classics. But we do here. Engaged participation in creating the text, in the sense that Andhakakkavi will continue to be asking us questions that he needs for us to answer, rather than trying to answer them in the text itself. The text on the page, in some ways, is a script, and the full text is the enactment of that script through public presentation of the text, asking questions of the text, learning the text, dealing with teachers. Playing with music and sound and phonics. This is inseparable of this text from the message that's being conveyed. When you take away the plumber, it becomes a less valuable text in terms of how beautiful it is. In a way that I don't think is quite as true for a text like Veeraraghava or Kamalawayam. The narrated world aligns with the narration. What the text is saying is also what it is doing. Andhakakkavi uses his first person all the time. It is a poem sung by a poet about poets who sing poetry. And all are expressing their love for Shiva with poetic words that themselves are the things that draw Shiva near. Questioning reality and questioning perception is also something that I think he cares about a lot. What these women feel or what they experience is continually learning the question of your doubts that are not resolved. Union of Shiva with poetic speech. Poetry is capable of expressing the instinctive, private experience of passion for the god in a way that speaks to universal experience. So the personal in some ways becomes the universal if it succeeds. You therefore surpass the limits of the self and can affect the world outside, which brings Shiva near. Finally, performance is procession, namely that the performance of this text itself creates the procession of the text, sending Shiva to the audience and creating, if successful, an experience within the listener's mind that corresponds to the successive experiences of the women in the text. So, with the Peyalum pen, the action begins when she's surrounded by singers and dancers, which by this point we know something good is about to happen. And she questions what music really is, laying out a complex series of associations that equate Kavi with Shiva himself. Dancers and female singers came and bowed before her. surrounding her as they sang all the while. Now she sings, entering both of Hyo's ears, twisting firewood on his matted locks, bearing the palm leaf letter to give to the chair. Already these deep illusions, entering both of Hyo's ears, reversed to the music of the two gandharvas that are his kavalas. Hoisting firewood onto his matted locks is describing Tomal Kedwan Niner, also in Vedrakaran, also in Vedrakaran. Bearing the palm leaf letter refers to the monarch who brings the letter from Madurai to Tomal Kedwan in his mountain kingdom, the Terumai. We return to the poem. Ravana, who wields a cruel sword, once sang the Vedas to receive a boon, and Niner danced before him in heaven. Collecting ambrosia for the light that rules us and the goddess of ancient Kadamba Grove, who keeps a Buddha at hand, here referring to Nanti and Madurai as the goddess of ancient Kadamba Grove. Opening the northern wall of Tiruvannamalai at midnight out of love, sitting under the shade of the banyan tree that pleasantly sways, Shiva really is the one like music when you think about it deeply. And the mythic illusions will start pouring forth. She throws the song into question, sensing that there's this union of word and sound that is somehow deeply linked to Shiva. Experience is challenged as the parallel men's active engagement with the myths of the past. This corresponds to the work you have to do to understand these verses are saying. Reveals the divine nature behind the song she is hearing, and the god is associated to the text being performed. And next she does an amazing thing. She starts to sing for herself and bring the Shaiva myths into the present, likening the dance being performed before her to the dance of the rhythm of song that Shiva himself does, and associating various aspects of her environment with telegraphic references to the hallowed actions of the Shaiva Nayanmar. So I'll just move through these two and how quickly the beautiful references come towards the end as she's singing her own song. And she starts to sing and praise the dance of the artist performing before her, as the dance to the rhythm of song performed by the true being of the Kali Age. She praises the flute of humble bamboo as the flute at the mouth of Anaya long ago. When her maids comb her beautiful hair, she happily speaks of the garland of hair that Mana Kantara gave. When she discusses the cruel eye of fate, she has pity, saying that it is really the left eye of Kanamaya. When she wants hot food, she calls it the fine work of the woman who cooked sprouts, of the woman who cooked pastries, and the woman who killed and cooked her own child. When she plays in the water of the tank with her beautiful friends, she honors the beautiful Pasapati Nayaka from the south. When she desires gold, she praises Manasinghamayam. When she sees golden paddy, she praises fearless Idambari. When she sees a golden lamp, she sings in great praise to Kalyan, Mamidandi, and Kamalapulan for their devoted service. When she picks clustered flowers buzzing with bees, she craves flower gardens made by the hands of Murugan and Kananathan. When she sees smoke with pure fragrance, she honors Kalyan. When she sees clothes, she honors the stylish Mason. When she sees green mangoes, she sings in memory of Bayan. When she sees the sweet one, she sings for Banyamite. When there is radiant sandalwood, she praises Murti. When there is sweet milk, she praises Pandi. And it keeps going. I mean, you could read these verses as a nice, concise tale of the 63 Nayanmar without ever knowing exactly what they did, unless someone teaches it to you. And she's singing the song herself, sort of restarting the chain of having others having to learn from her. Next, Andhakakkavi concentrates our attention on the poetic song, its relationship to Shiva, and its power to draw the god forth, voicing through the traditional figure of the Vidhi the question that lies at the very heart of the text. I quote, "And while this lovely goddess praised the time in songs like these, resting on a golden seat in the place she enjoys, the singer sang in the Sabari mode, crying out to know what pure humble song would make the Lord begin from Nambi come." This is referencing Nambi as Sundaramurti, a myth about Thirukkazhukundram, where Sundara goes to Thirukkazhukundram in the hopes that Sivakarama will give him gold instead of pies. Of course, it doesn't give him gold. And Pantundra complains, and at last, Siva comes out through a side door and gives him the gold. And what's wonderful here is that now it's the Vidhi, the figure of the past, all the way from the classical Sangam times, who's asking the questions. and the pamphlet then is the one with the answers. So she responds by citing a particularly suggestive pair of poets. First, Monica Lasseter, whose Tittamaskam represents for many people the real emotional heart of Donald Shaivism in the emotional core. And he is cited here only obliquely as a direct quote from the last line of his Adhigamam Thirukkazhukundra. You revealed yourself, God and I, is what it ends with. And so she begins the phrase that concluding each verse of the Adhigamam. Then she cites the verse of Nachimuttu, this first half of the verse that's left for you to figure out secondly. So she says, the impassioned woman cried, is there any song except for Thiruvasidam, perceived by the man who sang Kaganai? Are there any other words except for the words of the desirous woman, the Gariga who asked, won't you come to the courtyard and stand before me? And then we rushed to this narrative peak, which Andhakakkavi's audience probably would have been keenly anticipating. The pamphlet then makes the salvific identification of Tamar Ilakyam and Tamil poets with the divine itself, and she plunges then into the surge of passion for the god. So here's the verses. And when on that day she recognized the divinity of those who know the ancient Tamil texts and also of their poets, she said, sing, jewel lady. And the singer bowed and played on a well-tuned lute, raining drops of fresh honey. The flowing stream from her two wide eyes never stopped and poured over her breasts. Babbled words came from her mouth. She glowed with sweat, and as her heart began to tremble, the broad war drum roared, the ringing trumpets, and a host of conches and raised hands brayed. A whole world cried out, he is here, Hara, Shiva, Shankara. And the dark god and the unborn god pressed their lovely hands in worship. A rain of flowers fell from the gods, a rain of eyes fell from devotees, and a rain of arrows from the warrior and calm all vied with one another. The soft white chowdi, the parasol, and the banner of the bull rose high in the sea of the chariots of the gods, and the lord of crores of Rudras on parade, the supreme lord of London, and the lord of vultures gave an antid. The dancer and holy Thilai himself appeared on this street, the crowd roared whose foot jingles with the noise that in the dance that calls to me. I'm turn back to the first person there nicely, and overlapping with the piano and pen inside the quote, so they're starting to all collapse together. So that use of the first person in that last line of the piano and pen's quote is very striking. Who's the me? It's the piano and pen. It's Andhakakkavi. It's us in a certain way if we follow with in the performative moment. And the parallel pen is actually taken by Shiva. This is the only time I've seen this in Ula. She has figured out, she has sung her song. And the final verse of the text before it cites all the different shrines of Shiva says, while Kama and the other sphere, he possessed this fine woman, showing fear to her from the corner of his eye. She succeeded bringing the Tamil classics, the words within the words of the poets, into the present. And Andhakakkavi, I think, wants to be the one to lay the path for her, as he would for anyone who would want to read or recite his texts. Thanks.
Kelly. Questions?
Literary instance of Ula, specifically the hero in procession, being ogled and swooned over and whatnot by married as well as unmarried women, is clearly Kalidasa in the world's literary world. After that, we have got so much right down to modern times in Tamil. Do you have something like that in the other literature, non Tamil literature like Rajasthani, Magadhi,
or whatever? This is a really good question. As you say, sir, the Kalidasa locations there are very, very powerfully anchored in the tradition, I think. I've asked, the only South Asian languages that I have some working knowledge of are Sanskrit and Tamil. I've asked about Telugu, Malayalam, so there were southern traditions, nothing to the degree that you find in Ula or other than Ula. I have asked about Hindi, but Riti poetry, you know, so the classical tradition, have not found anything. I think, to be honest, this goes beyond, you know, what I was talking about today, but there's an interesting intersection between the Sangam Dinai and the idea of woman and aham, as sort of the gendering of female land responding to a ruler, that the Tamil poets really liked. So in Mupalayaram, you have Kaikilai verses in which the land itself is the woman who is responding to the hero in procession.
In Bhagavad, something you have Uttani Mata. Qualifying as of this type of Ula.
I think in the sense that it does have the processional trope in it, yeah, but it doesn't have the long seven stages involved in the larger Prabandham definition. In terms of the Chittilakyam, Bummer is the only one I know that really flourishes this. But more than that, it's of the Ulas I've sought out, it's a very Shaiva form. There's supposedly three Sri Vaishnava Ulas, none of which are extant. So I don't know what they actually say. There's a couple Jaina Ulas on leaders rather than Kirtankaras, but the vast majority are Shaiva texts.
The last one before the others, take me out. Talk about this Ula, the later examples that I've given are not exactly processions in which the women are saying something. The Viragatapa, that type of thing, you're doing something. Talking of that, incoming, these are all about poetry. Apart from poetry, the most recent ones are the songs. Actually, the Vindasati, like Karanam Chaturvadi. Allah and Allah and Vakya and Ittyano, Anna Parsive, Ram Kireno, like that. Do they qualify as Ula?
They wouldn't, too. I mean, part of it is, do you accept the definition of the Bakyals? Because after Panyera Bakyal, the following Bakyals took it as granted that Panyera Bakyal had defined the question. And the definition that they give is involved enough that it would not count as a Bakyalam.
And a number of songs are there in Tamil which I do not find in any other language.
That's not that. They don't talk about Ula.
But you do find texts that... There's these other texts on the interesting boundaries. Rukuta Pallet and these more Kuruvanji.
Kuruvanji.
Yeah, where you have very interesting intersections with these themes.
What would be the age of Uttalaya? Uttalaya. What would be the theme?
Oh, that's a difficult. I have thoughts on this. I see it as roughly contemporaneous with Bharatvaja. It refers...
Anterior to Bharatvaja.
Yes, that's how I see it. It refers to Madurai's Kula. It refers to Sati, which the first textual representations of Sati are just post-Kalidasa, right? But to be honest, you know, it's a guessing game in a large way, because of the purported text, we have perhaps 120 verses.
Yeah.
So, and that's why Apripile's Purutte, I think, is where he recovered most of that text. So, centuries later.
It's not.
Yes. Hero.
The Jain literature also has Uttar.
Oh, yes.
Apartanadula. The hero is.
Yes, I haven't read but it's seen. I should also note too that there's a deep Jain history to the processional motif, both in Perumkadai. You have repeated Ula-like scenes. And another text that's escaping me at the moment, sadly. Oh, Jiva Gajanamani, a vast processional scene there when he weds his final wife. So it has a long Jain history behind it as well.
Now, in terms of all these, the Prabandhams, the root of that need not necessarily have to come from any of the Sanskrit literature at all. And if you take a whole bunch of Nalaradhubya Prabandham verses, starting from Periyarvar, though maybe a little later than Kalidasa, there's plenty of versions of, you know, Pillai Tamil or other than say even Ula. Even Ula, you have reasonable references in case of Thirumangai Azhvar, Nammazhvar, which is you know, which may be the root rather than Kalidasa is what I think.
This is a good point. I was tracing a particular genealogy of Thirumangai's Thirukkazhukundra Ula, and that is close enough in repeated intraverse references to Kumarasambhava that it's almost at points of translation. And so I think within that particular genealogy of Thirukkazhukundra Ula, you can trace it through Kalidasa. But I wouldn't say that, of course, for all the Prabandham genres at all.
But in fact, you read that nothing like the Ula Prabandham came in the
Correct.
There is a piece like that in Kumarasambhava. That's all. It's a Prabandham by itself. Ula is a Prabandham by itself.
And the ones that I've never seen, if anybody knows where to find these texts, are the Ulas on modern political leaders. There's a Kamaraja Ula that exists, but I have not been able to find.
Kamaraja Ula.
I see.
Are there any websites on under the
Well, there's me. The process that I'm currently, Maya and I are at work on, that VC has kindly been helping us with, is to develop a, let me back up a second, which is that after you do Ana Ama Thamar in America, there's really no opportunities to go further with Ilakkam, except in very few places. So we wanted to develop a web-based curriculum that could move you from Padigams in the Nayamar, Andhakakkavi, through Andhakakkavi, also more modern stuff, because Thirukkazhukundra also has environmental issues because the Kalidasa no longer come. So there's been a lot of modern newspaper writing on these Kalidasa, including an effort to import them from Australia. So we did a succession of interviews with Guruka where he's singing the Sundara Padigams that will all be on the website. And Murais of all the Padigams of Mulvar and Manikavasa, all of Andhakakkavi's texts. And then there's a couple Thirukkazhukundra Puran Padigams that we will also be putting up there. So it soon will be there. Yeah.
When you approach texts like this, with you know, not a direct background in Tamil, and probably no commentaries available for a lot of these in the Sitralakya Vagayala, how do you even get into it in the first place?
Because we are interested.
Yeah, because it's not easy for a whole lot of us who have moved away from the traditional Tamil education.
Well, I think for me, you know, as a person who came to Tamil after dropping out of medical school, so this is my second life in a way, is I just try to stay humble to the tradition in the sense that for texts that only have modern gurais, it's just one possible version. And so I try to find different people who could teach me the text, who may have different trajectories of their own history. Certainly without Uwe Sa's published editions and his students writing the gurais, because it's after the 20s, I think it was primarily Uwe Sa's students who were writing the gurais, his guidance, I would have been lost in this text. But I've been blessed, you know, Tamil Nadu is a friendly place. Every time I've come here, people have been very happy to help teach me these texts. So the opportunities are non-existent, essentially, in the West. And you have to come here. So for me, that's been my strategy.
One other thing that you could probably do is to get a whole lot of the Tamil pandits who are still alive, who have come from the, you know, the traditional thing, to get them onto internet and get them direct access to you sitting where you are. You can.
And these people, you know, Gopal Iyer just recently passed in Pondicherry, and it was just such a huge loss. But he was one of the few people who worked very diligently at publishing while he was still alive. So his great Dev Autumn edition is out there. And hopefully, you know, as an outsider, may I say that India has no Institute for the Humanities, so there's very few resources for pundits to realistically engage in a publication project. You know, the economies of scale are very difficult. And I see it increasing rather than fading in some ways, this interest.
So well, particularly for Tamil, we do have some institutions with a lot of funding. But in terms of the quality of work, I mean, there's a Central Institute of Classical Tamil. But the sad thing is that for them, the definition of classical means it stops where all the things that you are talking about will not even come into that.
Up to the 7th century.
It stops at 7th century.
Exactly. There's a political commitment behind a lot of this that is, you have to work with realistically. Yeah. But you know, there's amazing people, amazing scholars at Alma Mater that I think of Wise O'Reilly's work, I think of Thirukkazhukundra Ula's work, I think, you know, just wrote, they're there and they've always been happy to work with someone from the, like me. So,
no, it's amazing that you have done things that we can't even dream of here. It's wonderful, actually.
Thank you. Yes, sir.
Historical information.
Absolutely. Some of it through reading across the grain. Sorry. But the Mughal is just vast with information. The problem with the Mughal genealogies is so many different people lay claim to the same public deeds in Chidambaram. So after Kulatunga starts really focusing royal patronage on Chidambaram, there's five different people who claim the patronage of gilding the shrine and redeveloping the streets. So this general Maralokaviran says that he did it, Kulatunga the second says he did it, Vikraman says he did it. And so I think we have to use these historical sites to the Mughal law in context with the Kalak did. Otherwise it's just a little too much of a project of power rather than history.
Two questions. One, why Thirukkazhukundra? Because it's not a major site for Shaivism.
Yeah.
That's the first question. Second, a bunch of us, half of us gathered here are going to Ajanta. And the Ajanta paintings are full of royal processions and processions by retinues and all that stuff.
Yeah.
And does this have anything to do with the Ula tradition, especially in Sanskrit from Kalidasa?
The first question is an easy one for me, it's just that I like the
Thirukkazhukundra. So why also
for Andhakakkavi? Why should he do that?
Well, Thirukkazhukundra was a major site for Andhakakkavi. It was not a minor shrine. It was right up there with Thirukkazhukundra. But of course, we also have to remember he got paid to do it. Right? So it was a local patron who paid him to compose it. So, but he sings very lovingly of the place and of Thirukkazhukundra in a way that I don't think is just being paid to sing of it. As for the Ajanta paintings, and we can go further too, right? In Sri Lanka, the cave paintings would be, and Thirukkazhukundra paintings, the Brihadishvara Kovil paintings have some of these themes as well. I see them more as just a larger trope of procession rather than Ula Paramu. Because what you don't have is the second half of Ula, which is really the critical defining part, which is first person narration from the woman's perspective. We're looking at the whole scene rather than seeing it from their eyes.
சைட்லேருந்து நாங்கள் நிறைய ஆங்கில இலக்கியத்தை படிக்கிறோம். அதை அணுகிறப்ப எங்களுக்கு இருக்கக்கூடிய ஒரு வியூ பாயிண்ட் இருக்கும். இப்போ நீங்கள் வந்து ஒரு தமிழ் இலக்கிய வகையை அணுகிறப்போ உங்களுக்கு இருக்கக்கூடிய அந்த ஒரு பார்வையும் அது ரெண்டுக்கும் ஏதாவது ஒரு இடத்துல ஒரு தொடர்பு இருக்குமா? அந்த கல்ச்சுரல் கான்டெக்ஸ்ட் தட் தி ஸ்ட்ரகிள் டு கோப் வித் அண்ட் ஹவு யூ நோ யூ இன் அ ஸ்ட்ரகிள் ஆர் ஈஸிலி take up the whole thing. It's a very difficult thing, but hopefully at some point in time, if I get time to talk to you about that, I would like to take it up. For a wonderful evening. Thanks a lot. And small form of thank you.